Hello, and welcome to Baltic Ways, a podcast bringing you interviews and insights from the world of Baltic studies. I'm your guest host, Ben Gardner-Gill, filling in for Dr. Indra Ekmanis. Dr. Una Bergmane is Academy Research Fellow at the Aleksanteri Institute, the Finnish Center for Russian and East European Studies at the University of Helsinki. She holds a PhD from Sciences Po and has been a fellow at Cornell University and the London School of Economics. Her first book, Politics of Uncertainty, the United States, the Baltic Question, and the Collapse of the Soviet Union, published by Oxford University Press in 2023, investigates the triangular relations between the U.S. government, Baltic independence movements, and Moscow during the perestroika years. Dr. Bergmane, congratulations on the publication of your book, and welcome to Baltic Ways.
Hi, thank you. Thank you for having me.
It is great to have you here. To start, can you just give us a brief overview of how you came to this subject and to this book project in particular?
This research originates from my doctoral dissertation. The doctoral dissertation, I wrote it at Sciences Po in Paris. And before the doctoral dissertation, there was actually a master's thesis, which was about the French reactions to the... at the time, I wanted to study... I knew that I was interested in international history, and I wanted to write something about the Baltic countries. At first, I was interested in the interwar period, but then I realized that that was a topic which was already much written about. And so I came to this time period in late 80s, early 90s, the collapse of the Soviet Union, the independence of the Baltic states. And first I looked at the French reactions. And it's very interesting because when I started to think about this topic, then, and I started to talk with people in the Baltic countries, with both historians and just scholars or just people around me, and telling what I was writing about, the first reaction very often was, oh, but there was nothing. Like, what international reactions? Nobody cared about the Baltic independence. And that was quite scary because I had to submit my master's thesis and there was not that much time to sit in the archives. But very quickly, I was very lucky. I got quite quickly access to the French archives, and those were recent archives. So I needed a special permission, but I got it. And then there were lots of things. And then I was very happy. And that slowly started from that, because once I wrote about the French reactions, then it seemed logical for the dissertation to kind of enlarge the scope and to look more both at Washington and Moscow and their attitudes toward Baltic claims for independence. And it just felt like a great topic with which I was happy to stay for both my dissertation and for my first book, because there are so many things to explore. And I think the main thing why this is so fascinating is that if we look at the Soviet Union as an empire, that at the heart of the empire, there is this asymmetrical relation between periphery and the center, between Moscow and the Baltic countries. And if we want to understand the collapse of the Soviet Union, we have to understand why and how this relationship, this imperial relationship, started to change. And I think for that, Baltic case is a very good case study.
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's a unique case study. It's one that provides unique insights, but it's also one that's been understudied. And so my next question is just, what new evidence does your research bring to light about this period with regards to the Baltic states in particular?
So there are lots of things that we can think about that the archives show. And I think that the most interesting thing which we can see at the title of my book, The Uncertainty. For a long time, I was struggling to kind of make sense of the hesitations in Washington and as well in Moscow regarding the Baltic case. I saw this different opinion, and that's something that appeared in the archives, different opinions, what should be done with the Baltic countries, lots of hesitation, very careful reflections about like what is too much, what is not enough in terms of like American policy regarding the Baltic countries. In the Soviet case, a lot of procrastination and understanding that there is a problem, that the problem will just become more and more important, more and more serious, but really an hesitation to take action, to decide about something that should be done with the Baltic situation. And I think that like when you are like a young researcher and you're writing your dissertation, then you often second guess yourself and you want to try to find sometimes something. I wanted to find some sort of like a logic in American or Soviet reactions. And it seemed impossible that there was just hesitation and uncertainty. But then at the end of the day, that's what it was. And at some point I realized I don't have to invent something that wasn't there. I just have to write about what I see in the archives. And what I see is uncertainty and hesitation. And that, of course, like if we think, especially about American foreign policy, so much of what has been written about the end of the Cold War, all of these, this scholarship and especially some sort of like a media accounts, it's constructed around the narrative of American agency, that Americans were able to reshape Europe, reunite Europe, put in place the new war, Cold War order to benefit from the weakness of the Soviet Union. And this uncertainty that I see when it comes to the Baltic question shows the limits of the American agency at the end of the Cold War. Because the existing power structures were changing. The existing power structures that existed during the Cold War, the existing power structures were changing. And the Cold War bipolarity was changing. And also the Soviet Union, such as it was known to the United States, was changing. And so these were uncharted waters in which the American side struggled to make sense of the power struggles in Moscow, the rapidly changing situation in the Soviet Union, what kind of the Soviet Union this was. This is something that Brent Scowcroft wrote in spring 1991. He wrote this very interesting memo for George Bush, in which he said that, like, there is this struggle going on in Moscow between the conservative forces and the pro-reform liberal forces. And if this struggle ended tomorrow with the victory of the conservatives or with the victory of the liberals, then at least we, the Americans, we would know with what kind of Soviet Union we are dealing. But as this struggle will be ongoing, and it's not going to end tomorrow, we are going to have to deal with this unknown entity, which is Soviet Union in motion, Soviet Union in deep change. And the same in Moscow. Again, existing power structures start to change. This imperial relation starts to change. And suddenly Moscow faces this pluralistic, increasingly democratic periphery in which the usual partner, the local Communist Party, these parties become more and more they are marginalized by other pro-independence forces. And so Moscow now has to understand with whom they can talk, whom they can trust in this rapidly changing political landscape. And they also have to understand what to do with these requests coming from the periphery to reform the federation or even to acquire independence. And so a lot of uncertainty that was very visible in the archives.
I can clearly see that. Well, clear is perhaps not the right word. It sounds rather muddled and messy. And this is where I'm curious as to your perspective on how that uncertainty then has played out in, we'll start with the bilateral relationship between the United States and what is now the Russian Federation. But I want to move to the Baltic states immediately after that. Obviously, certain forces won that battle in the spring of 1991. The Russian Federation has changed considerably since then, as I think it goes without saying. And now there is still uncertainty, perhaps of a different degree, as to what is actually happening in the Kremlin. Do you see parallels between your research and that period, you know, 30 years ago now, and the way that the two powers interact with each other today, especially within the context of the last year since Russia's second invasion of Ukraine?
Well, there definitely is. There are some similarities, but they are rather superficial. The similarities come when we in the West, in Washington, and also in European capitals, there is this question, what is happening in Russia? What is happening in Moscow? And probably also there is a similarity in the sense that Gorbachev's reforms made the West to realize that the Soviet Union is not exactly what they thought it was. And now the full-scale invasion of Ukraine has again made the West realize that Russian Federation is not exactly what it was thought to be. In both cases, there was a certain idea in the West that in the 80s, before Gorbachev came to power, the idea was that, well, we know what the Soviet Union is and we know what can be expected from it. And then there was a positive surprise. Gorbachev reforms, democratization, opening to the West. In the case of Russian Federation today, there was the unpleasant surprise. There was an idea again in the West or even in the Eastern Europe that we know what Russia is. There was probably more optimistic view in Western European countries, in Berlin, in Paris, more pessimistic view in the Baltic countries, in Poland, about what Russia is. But all these actors thought that they kind of knew what was to be expected from Russia. And then the full-scale invasion started. And there was a realization that, and there were very few people who actually thought that Putin would do something so irrational as to invade Ukraine. And so, again, people had to realize that that Russian Federation was not exactly what they thought it was. So in both cases, a surprise on one hand, in the first case, pleasant surprise, in the second case, very unpleasant one. And then, of course, uncertainty. What does it mean if we didn't really know what the Soviet Union was, if we didn't really know what Russian Federation was and is? So what does the future hold for us? And also similar question, but that's the internal question about international relations and the relations with the Soviet Union and Russia. How much pressure is enough and how much pressure is too much? And for example, when it came to the case of the Baltic independence, and of course we talk about a very different situation, but when it came to the Baltic independence, the United States in principle supported the Baltic independence. And the United States supported Baltic independence and they were willing to put some extent of pressure on Moscow, especially in order to prevent use of force in the Baltic countries. But there was this constant stress in the White House not to do too much, not to destabilize the power of Gorbachev. And on the other hand, International Security Council, and especially Condoleezza Rice, was saying, but we are not putting enough pressure for Gorbachev to take us seriously. We don't want to exaggerate. We don't want to destabilize him. We don't want to jeopardize the relations with the Soviet Union. But at the same time, we also want the Soviet Union and Moscow and Gorbachev to understand that we are serious about this. So this the question that we also have today, how much pressure, how much support for Ukraine is appropriate? And there is a certain current of thought to which I do not subscribe, but people saying, oh, but if we do too much, Putin will just snap and we will have a nuclear war. And I think that's also a result, like Putin is consciously projecting this image of this. Well, I think that currently Russian Federation is playing with this fear that, well, if you do too much, we will just go crazy and drop the nuclear bomb. But we see these recurring patterns. The differences are, of course, that the main difference is that Gorbachev and Putin are two very different people. When Gorbachev passed away last year, then there was a lot of debate. Has he been idealized in the West? Have we talked enough about kind of the dark sides of his tenure, the use of force in the Baltic countries, the use of force in Baku, in Tbilisi, the aftermath, how he handled the aftermath of Chernobyl, the use of force in Alma-Ata, which was the first case in Kazakhstan? And of course, Gorbachev should not be, he has to be questioned and people has to look at his legacy critically. But obviously, he was a very different person from Putin. And I think the main difference was that even though during his tenure, at some point he used force when it was not necessary, and there were civilian victims as a result. But in general, he was somebody who was, he had certain aversion regarding extensive state violence, whether in international relations or in domestic politics. That is one difference. And Putin, obviously, he has no problems with extensive violence. The other issue is, and that's also the big difference, Gorbachev cared a lot about creating a positive image of the Soviet Union in the West. He wanted the Soviet Union to be part of the international community. Putin doesn't care at all about the positive image of Russian Federation, and I don't think he wants Russia to be part of some sort of like a Western international community. So, and that makes a huge difference. And then, of course, at the time, the West were dealing with a collapse of an empire, which was a complicated task to deal with. But today, the task is even more complicated because they are dealing with a full-scale war, a violation of international law, and an attack against a sovereign state, Ukraine, by Russian Federation. So the scale and the seriousness and the danger today is much, much bigger.
Yes, yes, obviously. You know, I think the only thing that immediately to my mind compares from the early 90s was what was going to happen with the nuclear weapons, you know, that were housed in Ukraine and Kazakhstan in terms of like what could be closest to an existential threat and a major security risk. But that is entirely different to what we're facing today. You had a couple points in your reply there, which I found really interesting. I want to pull on and bring back to the Baltic states here. First, going backwards from, I remember when Gorbachev passed last year, seeing some reflections from folks in Central and Eastern Europe saying essentially, you know, the further east you went, the less idealized he was, where people in the United States had a particular opinion of him. And then Western Europe was another way. Central Europe was another way. And countries that had been occupied by the Soviet Union were another way entirely. One theme that we've all seen, we've heard, we've participated in over the course of the last year since the second invasion of Ukraine is the conscience of the Baltic states and their and similarly minded neighbors. So I think we could include Poland in that. I think and to some extent Finland as well, for example, coming to greater prominence within the broader European and NATO debates about, not to say we told you so, but we've been warning. And this goes back also to the question of this agency of the Baltic states, which has been discounted in the literature, at least, but also as just in common parlance as, well, the United States liberated the Baltics from the Soviet Union. Not exactly. You know, we have to ascribe agency where it is due. Could you talk a little bit about how that has transpired over the last 30 years, how that's developed? I mean, it seems like there's been this massive movement and recognition across the alliance, let's say, within the last year because of how the Baltic states and again, similarly minded neighbors have positioned themselves. But obviously that doesn't come out of thin air. It wasn't the same situation on February 23rd, 2022, as it was in spring of 1991. Where were the major movements in between? And, you know, what does your research show might be the next steps coming out of that period in the early 90s?
Yeah, so the Baltic countries and the agency of the Baltic countries, I think it's even more important. So it's obviously, as you underlined, that this idea that the United States somehow liberated the Baltic countries from the Soviet Union, really not really the case. The United States, in principle, agreed that the Baltic countries should become independent. But then there was some sort of like we can see as a hierarchy of international problems at the time. So there was the question of German unification, and the United States were willing to support, and they supported publicly the unification of Germany, and the United States were willing to actively put a lot of pressure, completely disregarding the consequences for Gorbachev, upon the Soviet Union to obtain German unification on Western terms, basically meaning membership, German membership, the membership of United Germany in NATO. So that was on the top of these international hierarchies. And then the Baltic question was somewhere at the second place, where the United States were willing to publicly support the idea of independence, but the White House was not willing to put a pressure or to actively do something substantial to make that independence happen. And then there was the third case, which were all the other Soviet republics. And in that case, the United States were not willing to publicly support the independence. They didn't think that other Soviet republics should become independent. And obviously, they were also not willing to do anything practical about it. So we see this hierarchy, and the Baltic states were better positioned than the other Soviet republics. And that was due both to the tradition of non-recognition. So the United States never recognized the Baltic countries as being legally part of the Soviet Union, because of the way how the Baltic states in 1940 were occupied and then illegally annexed by the Soviet Union, but also because of the activities of Baltic diaspora and the links they had with the Congress. So they were in a better position than other Soviet republics, but the Baltic states were not, they were, their position and their situation was much worse than that of Germany. The German interests were absolutely prioritized, often at the expense of the Baltic countries. And so here we see the agency, the political will. We see it on the grassroots level, people going to manifestations, people joining the independence movements, people actively participating in the first free elections in the Soviet Union, electing democratic parliaments with majority of pro-independence forces. And then those pro-independence forces, when they came to power, really pushing the Baltic question on the international agenda, trying to obtain meetings and successfully obtaining meetings at the White House, in London, in Élysée Palace, in Paris, actively also talking with Gorbachev. So we see the political will to obtain independence on the Baltic side. And much of this consisted of the Baltic countries acting and then Moscow reacting and then the United States reacting to either Baltic actions or Soviet reactions. But we can't really see any substantial initiative on this in this regard coming from the United States. So as you said, it's not the liberation of the Baltic countries. It's Americans adjusting their policy to what's happening on the ground. And actually, and so today, of course, the question of NATO enlargement, I think we are past probably and hopefully this narrative about how Russian Federation was mistreated by NATO enlargement. And that's why all the bad things has happened. And that's why they had to invade. There were people who seriously would say at the beginning of the war that that's why this Russian Federation had to invade Ukraine because of NATO enlargement. Well, I hope that we, as I said, we are past that narrative. But if we think about NATO enlargement, how it has been presented in media and also in the scholarship as this event that basically concerned the big powers, United States expanding their zone of influence, or NATO expanding itself towards the East. And yes, of course, NATO is a tool of American influence. And yes, of course, NATO countries actively agreed to expand. The NATO enlargement was in the interests of NATO members. But we also have to understand that the NATO enlargement also happened because both Central Eastern European countries and the Baltic countries really wanted to join NATO. Central Eastern European countries were the first ones who started to talk about this, who started to push for the enlargement. And for the Baltic countries, NATO enlargement basically was, there was no other possibility, or there were no other security guarantees as certain as that NATO, the Article 5 of North Atlantic Treaty. So if we think about why NATO did enlarge, we also have to think about this Baltic perspective that they were seeking security guarantees to solidify their sovereignty and their independence. And if we think, who could have done something differently back in the 90s? Yes, probably the West could have done something to reassure Russian Federation more, even though there were things that were done, such as NATO-Russia Council that functioned for quite a long time. But also on the Russian side, they could have tried and they could have done a better job making sure that Eastern, Central Eastern European and Baltic countries don't live in this existential anxiety about the Russian threat. And it this ontological fear of Russia, which Baltic countries have often been seen as exaggerating and or being hysterical about this. But now the February 24th unfortunately proved them right, that Russian Federation still harbors very aggressive plans regarding its neighbors. And I think both the full-scale invasion proves that the Baltic countries were absolutely right to join NATO, but also Swedish and Finnish decision to join NATO shows that neutrality is not an option on Russian borders. These two countries that historically have a fantastic record of neutrality they have made the decision that the Baltic countries made in the 90s, that neutrality is not an option anymore.
Absolutely. I'd say we're at a point of flux, so to speak, which is putting it mildly, but accurate, perhaps. So clearly, there's still reverberations of your research to the present day. Again, putting it mildly, where is your next project? I know you're just publishing your first book, but where is your next project? Where are you, you're turning your eyes and your attention next?
So I have, thanks to the Academy of Finland and Helsinki University and Alexandra Institute, I have this fantastic opportunity. With the funding of Academy of Finland, I have a five-year funding, which is fantastic, and I'm very grateful for that. So I have this five-year funding to study collective memory dynamics at the time of Perestroika, at the time of Gorbachev's tenure. So I'm basically looking at the way how the changing power relations, something that continues from my previous project, we see how Perestroika brings change and power dynamics in the Soviet Union. And these power dynamics and increasing democratization also enables people to reconsider and revisit the history of the Soviet Union. There was an official discourse in the Soviet Union about what the Soviet Union was and what was the history of the Soviet Union. But despite the state capacity to impose this discourse upon the public space, there was always these marginalized memory groups. I really like this concept, which was used, which I learned from a colleague of mine, Philip Pershok, marginalized memory communities, groups of people whose perception of the past didn't fit this official discourse. And these marginalized memory groups, as also Philip has shown in his research, these marginalized memory groups gained access to the public space at the time of Gorbachev, and then they became the mainstream memory carriers in the 90s. And I'm looking at this moment when these people gain access to public space and they start to challenge the official discourse, but they also start to challenge, to some extent, the legitimacy of the Soviet Union. For example, one of my case studies is the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact. When the Baltic memory activists, so people who were actively engaged in an effort to change this official discourse, when Baltic memory activists start to talk about the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact and the secret protocol in which the Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union divided in zones of influence Eastern Europe, they put in question the founding myth, the second founding myth of the Soviet Union, which is the Second World War and the Great Victory. And the Soviet power in the Baltic countries was legitimized through this narrative of liberation. We liberated you, so, well, you now are part of the Soviet Union. You have to be part of the Soviet Union. And, the secret protocol of Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact puts a very different perspective upon this. So the links between the past and the future, in the sense that, well, the past, the different understanding of the past made people to reimagine the future as independence or as something else. So yeah, that's my next project, which I'm very excited about.
It sounds fascinating. Can't wait to see what comes of that in whatever form it does. And maybe we can talk about it again on Baltic Ways. So Dr. Bergmanet, thanks so much for joining us and good luck with the project.
Yeah, thank you very much.